You're watching the Spirit Food Christian Center Worldwide Webcast, broadcasting live every Sunday at 10 a.m. Pacific Time.
Yes, amen, hallelujah. When spirit food comes to you, blessings will flow. Say yes.
That which I'm holding in my heart, the holy written word of God. The Bible is God speaking to me. I am what the Word of God says I am. I can do what the Word of God says I can do. I have what the Word of God says I possess. I am a believer, not a doubter. Therefore, God's Word is being confirmed in my life with signs following. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah and amen. Turn your Bibles, please, to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I'm teaching on we're born to raise, lift up heaven, God's kingdom, and to raise, R-A-Z-E, cut down hell and its operation and its kingdom. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, the Apostle Paul, writing to the believers, lets us know that we who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we are new creation people. We are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We are born from above. We are children of the Most High God. And as children of the Most High God, we have responsibilities. As children of the Most High God, we have privileges. As children of the Most High God, we are not limited to natural weapons in this warfare. We are not fighting against flesh and blood. Our warfare is not against natural things. Why? Because the devil manipulates the natural things to try to get us focused on the natural thing so that we could try to fight a physical battle instead of operating in the victory that we've been given in fighting spiritually. This ministry is called Spirit Food. Why? Because man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. If you are called to eat and to taste and see that the Lord is good, what is it that you're called to taste and to eat? The Word of God. For God's Word is food for our spirit. And you're to come here with the understanding that I'm going to be spiritually taught. I'm going to have my spirit fed with the Word of God. I'm going to walk by faith, which is a spiritual gift given to me in Christ Jesus. And that I can develop and walk by faith and not by sight. And I can really win in life because I fight the good fight of faith. And the only reason it's called a good fight is because the fight you win is good. You don't want to fight a battle and be getting beat up on and losing and call it a good fight. That was not a good fight. The only fight that's good is the fight you win. And all the people of God said, amen. And therefore we can say, thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're already winners. So our responsibility then is to learn how to enforce our winning, how to enforce our victory, how to walk like what we really are, winners in Christ Jesus. And all the people of God said, amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, are you there? The Apostle Paul said in verse 1, now I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am base among you, but being absent am bold toward you. That means that when people saw the physical Paul, that was the apostle of the Lord, they said, well, man, you don't look all that big. We read your letters, and your letters are strong, and we've heard about your ministry, how you've cast out demons, how you've raised people from the dead by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, how that the authorities were looking for you and holding up the whole city to try to cause you to be brought to what they believe is to a physical end. Paul, you are well known, and people know you as a powerful influence in our day. But when we see you in the flesh, man, you ain't all that big and you don't look all that strong. What's up? Paul said, I may look like I'm base among you. That means I may look like I ain't all that. But see, you better pay attention to what I am spiritually, because I'm bigger inwardly than I am outwardly. Let that sink in for a moment. I'm bigger inwardly than I am outwardly. That means my spirit is much stronger and bigger than you see my physical body. Because they looked at him and they said, well, we can take you. He said, don't you even try, because I know how to operate in the spiritual knowledge of the word of God. Now keep your finger here and turn over to Colossians. Keep your finger on marker there at 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and look at Colossians, because we who come to spirit food are learning how to feed our spirit and how to walk in faith in great ways, because faith is a spiritual force given unto us by God. And the more we know of spiritual knowledge in the word, the better we are. Amen. All right, verse 9, Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. I'll look at verse 9 here. It's so good. Ready? For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will and all what? And all wisdom and what? And spiritual understanding. And all what? Wisdom and spiritual understanding. Underline the word spiritual understanding. You see, we're here to learn how to be people who are equipped spiritually. Why? Because when we walk spiritually and understand spiritual things, then we're more than capable to walk in victory in natural things. You're there in Colossians. Turn a few pages to your left to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians, the sixth chapter. When you have it, say praise the Lord. Just a couple of pages over, a few pages over. Depends on how big your Bible is. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in your physical body. Is that what he's saying? No. He said, be strong in your own physical abilities. No. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles, that means trickery, schemes, plots, plans, ambushments. He's letting you know, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore I take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all, stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the what? The word of God. Praying always with all prayer. Another translation says this way, praying always with all manner of prayer. That means there are different types of prayer. Make sure you know how to pray effectively. Make sure you know that there are different types of prayers. And don't you be one who's not aware of the various prayers that are offered you as a part of your armor. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for how many? For all saints. Now the Apostle Paul then lets us know we have to be girded up. We've got to be people who are suited and booted. We have to be people who are ready and consider that what we are engaged in this world that we live in, that we are engaged in conflict. The devil does not like you. You rest assured, the devil is not your friend. And all the people of God said, amen. Amen. The devil is not my friend. Everybody say, the devil is not my friend.
The devil is not my friend.
He only means to kill,
to steal,
and to destroy. And because I know Jesus as my Lord, and I love him with all my heart,
I'm not the devil's friend.
He's defeated,
and I'm the victor.
In Jesus' name, amen. Now, because we are the children of the Most High God, because we are born of His Spirit, we live in physical bodies, but we spiritually are called the children of the Most High God. And therefore, we ought to be what? Well clad spiritually. Clad means well dressed, properly suited in our uniform. The enemy does not like you at all. He means you no good. If he's talking nice, it's only to try to bring you down. If he looks like he's trying to coax you into something good, better than what God has, note this. He did the same thing to Adam and Eve, and Eve went for it, and we're here today dealing with stuff that don't even make any sense because of the devil being able to move in the earth realm through Adam's transgression. What I'm telling you all is this. We live in an environment of conflict. But for us who are in Christ Jesus, we have the victory.
Amen.
We must manifest. We must enforce our victory. Turn back over in your scriptures then to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We must be people who are strong in faith. We must be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. We must be people who are properly clad. My feet have spiritual shoes on them. The gospel of peace, and I know how to put the enemy under my feet. I what? I seek peace. I pursue peace. I'm going to have peace. I'm not going to have conflict where I go and conflict be around me and strife and confusion be around me. I don't have that. I put everything under my feet. Because my feet are properly clad with the gospel of peace.
Praise God.
And on the bottom of those shoes that the warriors or Roman soldiers used to wear, they had spikes on the bottom of their shoes. And so oftentimes when people had engaged them, like crowds would be coming and they would have to crowd control, they would let the people know, get out and get dispersed, because if you don't, we're going to walk on you. And when they walked on them, that didn't mean we're just going to step on you. That meant that those spikes on the bottom of their shoes was going to do some damage. And they annihilated their enemies by walking on them. And they would just mow them over. And when they stepped on them, those people had some changes to their anatomy. And what Paul the Apostle was letting us know as Christians, we must be people who refuse to allow the devil to have any place. We must keep him under our feet. Amen?
Amen.
You're there in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1. Paul said, now I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who am present and base among you, but being absent, am bold toward you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present. In other words, I'm appealing to you so that when I come to you, I won't have to walk around like you're my enemy. Because he's writing to believers and he says, please don't let me have to come to you and utilize my spiritual weaponry to have to deal with you. Because we're family and you're fellow soldiers. So therefore, let the confidence that I have toward you Let that confidence be truly sincere and you're willing to respond to it. Verse 2, 2 Corinthians 10, verse 2. But I beseech you that I may be bold when I am present with that confidence, wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons, everybody say weapons. That means more than one weapon. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. That means they're not fleshly, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Now, Paul the Apostle is informing them, hey, listen, we all have the same weaponry. Are you properly clad and are you willing to do what your job is as a soldier in the Lord? You're supposed to pull down strongholds. That means you look to tear down. That means you look to tread over. You look to plow under. You look to dig up and to root out all evil. Instead of evil trying to peacefully coexist with you, which it's not ever going to try to peacefully coexist with you, evil is always trying to take you over. But you have to do something. You have to be actively engaged in the warfare that we're called to. And remember, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're what? Mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. My wife and I, we were at a restaurant, and these ladies were fighting in the street, slamming each other on the ground, and jewelry was going in places, and they were pulling out each other's hair and all that kind of stuff. And my wife looks and said, is there any man in here that can do something about this? Well, I'm with her. What you think I'm going to do? I saw them out there in the street fighting, stopping traffic, and literally just doing all kind of damage to each other. I saw it. But I'm thinking, man, let me order my food and get up out of here. My wife, she yelled out, though, is there a man that can do something about this? I'll be the man. So I opened up the restaurant door, and they were fighting outside the restaurant door there in the street. And I said, in Jesus' name, stop it right now. I said it again. In Jesus' name, stop it right now. And they stood up, picked up their stuff, got out of the street, went over to the side. Got in the cars and left. And I went on and had my meal with my wife. Got the food and we left. My point being is this. If I had not have exercised my rights and my authority and my power for weapons in Christ, no telling what would happen there. There could have been a murder. Because grown folks fighting, I mean, it could result in murder. And I really shouldn't have had to be told by my wife, is somebody going to do something about it? Is the man going to do something about it? I should have actually exercised my own authority just knowing that, because I wasn't happy with what I saw. I knew that what I saw was crazy, and I saw all the traffic stopping, and I saw these women beating up each other. I knew how to shut it down. What was on my mind? Eating, huh? That's what was on my mind, eating. Thinking, we'll just get our food and get up out of here. But God requires us as believers to start pulling down, treading out, exercising our authority. There are things that are going on that you know are crazy. People have lost their mind and they're operating spiritually out of order. And they think it's okay because nobody's going to check them. It's time for the people of God to check them.
Amen.
It's time for the people of God to rise up and say, Satan, not here, not where we are, because we have authority. You're still there in 2 Corinthians chapter 10? Verse 3, let's all read it out loud. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. Verse 4, everybody. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Now, he tells us, our is not just him, Paul the Apostle. He's saying all of us who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, The weapons of our warfare is not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. People, the world is looking for those who will rise up and take the position and start shutting this stuff down. That is not in line with God's will. Verse 5. Casting down what? Imaginations. Now, what does that mean? That means the devil tries to give you images in your mind that go contrary to the will of God. An example of that would be in Genesis, where Eve, after having a conversation with the devil, then she saw that the tree was good for food, that the tree was one to be desired, and that would make one wise. Well, she didn't have that kind of sight beforehand, before she got into a conversation with the devil. The devil was talking to her, and she received the visions of the words that were given unto her, and she started seeing things differently. Now, this thing is also so, as it's written in Scripture, regarding Sodom and Gomorrah and Lot. Lot seeing and hearing their evil deeds consistently vexed his righteous soul. Lot knew what was right and good by God. He was the nephew of Abraham. And when he went into Sodom and Gomorrah, he was not an individual that had any problems with judgment. But boy, oh boy, after having been there for such a long time, hearing and seeing their unlawful deeds, even though it bothered him spiritually, it vexed his righteous soul, he was still a man that could retain judgment. Because when he said to the people that tried to rape the angels that came to visit him, the angels took upon the form of men to come deliver Lot and his family from Sodom and Gomorrah, because God said to Abraham, I cannot destroy this place until Lot is gone, or those that are righteous. It wasn't even 10 righteous people. The angel said, let's go, Lot, it's time to go. The men were at his door, the young to the old, there to try to rape the angels, thinking that they were just visitors. He said, well, man, I got daughters. You all want my daughters? They said, no, we don't want no daughters. We want the men. He said, well, don't do this wicked thing. This is wickedness. He said it himself. Lot said it himself. This is wickedness. They said, so now you were a visitor coming into our land, and now you have made yourself a judge. So we'll just take you and rape you then. And they pulled him out and started to work him over. The angels reached out, grabbed Lot, pulled him in after striking all of them blind. And they went to looking around, seeing what they could do. But see what's going on. Spiritual warfare. Spiritual warfare. You got people now that are just evil. They hate those that want to do right and good. They have no desire to see God have his expression in the earth realm. So what do? They try to make those who love God look stupid. I told my wife, I said, I should come out with a blog called Through His Eyes. You know, there's things that I see, we go to movies, or if we see a movie or we see something, and just knowing that people need to understand how spiritual things work. That if you align yourself with God, God is a spirit. And them that worship him must worship him in what? Spirit and in truth. If you look at things spiritually, you'd be all right, if you're willing to align yourself spiritually. But you get out in the wrong position spiritually, it don't matter. It doesn't matter if you don't like the devil. If you're playing on the devil's team and you're working, punching on the devil's time clock, you're going to deal with the things that the devil passes out, which is destruction. For it is written in the book of Romans, the wages of sin is death. He wasn't writing that to sinners. He was writing that to believers. You get the plan and checking in on the devil's time clock, you're getting a paycheck from the devil. So stop punching in on the devil's time clock. My wife and I just saw the movie Get Out, it was called, right? Is that what it's called? Get Out. Wow. Man, I thought that was an impactful movie because it allowed for people just to see how things go on that you don't really consider. The biggest thing was this. How does one get in a position where they need to get out? Let me read what it says here. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. You there?
Yes.
Verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Verse 6. Everybody together. And having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Read verse 6 again. And having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Now what that means is this. You can't be serving the devil, working for the devil, doing what the devil is telling you to do, and then talk about, devil, get out of my face. The devil looks at you and laughs. You're not in a position to revenge all disobedience. Why? Because your obedience is not fulfilled. You can't tell the devil, devil, get out of here, I hate you, but come here and give me some more stuff to do. That's work. Either the devil is the enemy or the devil is your friend. You got to determine which side you're going to take. And having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Now, I don't want to give a spoiler alert to the movie, but I thought the movie was a great deal. My wife said, don't tell it. So anyway, I'll use something on that line. No. Let me just, I'll use a biblical example. See, are they paying you to watch the movie? Look, I'm just saying, I thought the movie was really, really indicative of what I'm teaching on. And that is this, you can't serve the devil and not be, and you can't serve the devil and be strong in the power of God to try to defeat the devil. Are you listening?
Yes.
Now, the biblical example of that is Samson. Samson was an individual that God had blessed. He was Jewish and he loved God. Or I should say it this way, his parents loved God, but yet sometimes people take the love of God and the grace of God and the blessings of God for granted. They're like, you know what? God's good to us, but we can do what we want to do. We can cut up, act up, serve the devil, do whatever we want to do. Because they think, see, God's mercy and God's judgment, he hadn't dropped any judgment on us, so we all good. But see, they're forgetting that there's another person to this equation, the devil, who is just straight cruel. The devil is cruel. Let there be no mistake about it. All he wants to do is kill, steal, and to destroy. Somebody said, well, I don't understand the devil. I'm telling you about the devil. He only wants to kill, steal, and to destroy. That's all he's about. And all the things that he does is to get to kill him, steal him, and destroy him. Well, Samson was a little boy growing up, and it came time for him to get married, or he was of age where he could decide. He told his dad and mom, he says, look, I like these women that are outside of our covenant with God. And his father said, son, we don't do that. We're going to walk with God. He's like, no, we're not. Yeah, we can walk with God, but I like these Philistine women because they look good and they please me. And he said, the father said, son, let it go, man. There's plenty of women in the body or the Israeli family who have an understanding of the covenant that God gave us through Moses, because the structure of a family is acknowledged in the books of writing by Moses. Samson said, Dad, I hear you, but you know, you're just a religious churchgoer. You know, that's good for you in your day, but for me, this is a new day, new time period. I can do what I want to do, right? His father's like, look, I ain't for it, because I'm telling you, don't ever think you're smarter than God. Samson said, that's what a person who's old would say. Give me my woman that I want. Samson got a Philistine woman. And he ran into all kind of problems. Her daddy, his father-in-law, gave his wife to somebody else. I said, his father-in-law took his wife and said, you're his wife now, somebody else's wife. Samson comes home and he's like, what's up? Where's my wife? Oh, I gave it to your friend. I thought you didn't like her because she told the answer to your riddle. What are you talking about? We may have had some disagreement, but I'm not getting rid of my wife. What person would get rid of their wife? See, he's thinking from a Jewish side, your father can't come in and tell his daughter you belong to somebody else now. That's crazy. From a Jewish side, from a Gentile pagan side, they got a right to do that. Now, they don't have a right with God, but that's how pagans think. Pagans think wrong is right, right is wrong. I can do what I want to do, and I don't have to listen to God. So Samson went to get his wife, and he come to find out, it's like this whole thing is crazy. Bottom line, long story short, Samson gets his heart broken, and even though he's strong, where he could take a several ton gate and carry it on his back, because they tried to lock him in, he put the gate on his back and walked away, up a hill. Took 300 foxes, put them tail by tail, and put a torch on their tails and tied them, lit the torches and let the foxes that were trying to run away from the fire run through the fields of the Philistine and burn up all their crops. Samson, when he got angry, he let you know. You had to guess about it. The Philistine people burned his wife, ex-wife, burned his ex-wife and her father's household. Samson's like, you know what? Now women ain't no good. I ain't got no respect for women. I'm never going to give my heart to another woman. So he goes out and gets a hooker. And he falls in love with a hooker. When I say in love, I should say it this way. He falls in lust. In lust with a hooker named Delilah. And Delilah was approached by the men of the city and said, you know what, this guy Samson, he's a little bit too much of a threat. He's a danger. We want him out. And they said, "Why?" They said, Delilah, he spends a whole lot of time with you. Tell us, how does this man have all of this strength? She said, I don't know. He hadn't told me. They said, well, if there's anybody can know, you can find out. Why? Because that pillow talk sure goes a long way. Did y'all hear what I said? I said, pillow talk goes a long way. Now, this is one of the reasons I'm going to help you understand a little history. Alexander the Great was a Grecian leader, and he didn't believe that wealth and authority and power should be shared with women. So men were told, when you have intimate relationship with somebody, you're giving up your capacity to be strong. You're giving up your capacity to be what? To withhold the wealth and the strength. Wealth transference and power and knowledge, excuse me, is transferred and has the capability of being understood by the person you go to bed with. And so Alexander the Great promoted homosexuality. Because he believed that men should keep the power with what? With men. Why? Because two men can keep their money, still have sexual fulfillment, and not have any kids. And you can still be a senator, a governor, a leader in the nation, and maintain your money and your prestige, and you know what? Still be sexually fulfilled. And so he said, he promoted homosexuality. Don't think it's not about economics. It is about economics. It is about sharing of wealth. And he didn't want, Alexander the Great did not want wealth shared with the women. He wanted to eliminate the women's ability to take over in the Grecian society. So he kept the men aware. This is how you're supposed to have sexual fulfillment. Stay with men. Use women for slaves and maybe have companions, but don't you ever, ever give your heart to a woman, because when you have a relationship with a woman, that's where your heart is going to go, and that's where your money will end up, and that's where your prestige will go. Some of you didn't know that, but that's the way it went. In the situation with Samson, he had a Nazarene vow. That meant he was a person who had a vow with God. Nazarene vow means you can't cut your beard and you can't cut your hair. So Samson had long hair and long beard. But Samson was some kind of big-looking guy. Now, I don't know if he was big in stature, but he was straight up anointed with power. And Delilah said to him, I'm going to find out what makes you so powerful. And he started lying to her and telling her, well, if you do this, I'll do that. Bind me with cords. I won't be able to get away. And she had him bound with cords. And the moment he was bound with cords, the soldiers came in, and he would break the cords and beat up the soldiers. And this happened over and over. And then finally she cried and said, Samson, Samson. Oh, Samson, I thought you said you loved me. Oh, here I am. I'm giving you all of my time and my loving. And you won't tell me what really is the most important thing to you in your heart. Oh, Samson, how come you won't tell me? How come you won't tell me? I'm really, oh, you hurt my heart because you won't confide in me your most intimate secrets. And really all she's doing is acting like a regular Philistine. Which was to what? Which was to get after the weaknesses of your enemy. Now, how come you can understand that the enemy will try to go after your weaknesses and forget that the devil is the one behind your enemies? So Samson, the Bible says, and she lay with him all that night, and she had him asleep with his head on her lap. Meaning that she put it on him and he could not what? He's like, hey, whatever. He's just sex drunk. Sex drunk. No, that's the real deal. And because he's sex drunk now, he's like, he's grogging the whole thing. And she said, well, Samson, tell me, where's your strength come from? Tell me where your strength comes from. Don't lie to me like you did before, because I know you don't have no strength now. I done took your strength. And he said, yeah, I got a covenant with God. And my covenant with God is symbolized by the length of my hair. And I chose to be a Nazarene and to have a vow of God. And you know what? My hair is very important to me, because if it ever gets cut, that means that I've cut off my covenant with God. She said, thank you very much. Give me some sugar. She put him back to sleep. She says, Samson, wake up, wake up. The soldiers are upon you, as she has said before. And he was bound up, and he's like, I'll just simply break these things off of me like I've done before, and I'm going to have to whip some more soldiers. But this time he has no strength. His hair was cut, and his strength was gone, because the Bible says you can revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. And Samson had been playing and trying to punk God, tell God, yeah, I know what you want, God, but I ain't going to do it. And then finally God said, that's where you want it? I'll back off. Have at it yourself. And God backed off, and Samson didn't have any strength, and they took him and put pokers, red hot pokers, and burned out his eyes, and his hair was cut. And then they made him a sporting event. Finally, Samson came to the place of saying, God, I know I missed it. And the Bible talks about the goodness of God leads you to repentance. You know, when you see how good God is, even though a person has not done right by God, when you know how good God is and it really dawns on you, like the prodigal son, my daddy was good and God has been good to me. I'm coming back and I'm going to get right with God. Well, see, Samson is like, God, I got to talk to you. I've been blowing it. I know it. I'm going to get right with you. I'm going to get right with you when? Right now. Now, Samson's hands were against the pillars of the amphitheater for the Philistines. And they were making sport out of him. And he said, Lord, at least let me die the glorious death of one who is now obedient to you, than to die of shame, being always ridiculed by these my enemies. And God anointed him. And Samson pushed with his own hands, by the power of the anointing, the foundational pillars, load-bearing pillars of that amphitheater, and that whole thing came down, crashing down around, and thousands of people died in that amphitheater because of Samson's willingness to say, I will obey. Now, yes, Samson died, but he killed more in his death of the enemy than he did when he was alive. And he took out a whole bunch of people. He was the one that took a jawbone of an ass and killed. How many people did he kill? 1,000? 1,000 Philistines, soldiers, with the jawbone of an ass. This man had some power. This man tore a lion in two and took honey outside of the lion that was inside of the lion's belly. This man was no joke. And what I'm getting at is this. His willingness to be obedient now, to repent and say, God, do your thing. Use me, even if it's my death, but at least allow my enemies not to be able to glory over me. Have you all come to the conclusion that you refuse to live for the devil?
Yes.
Have you come to the place where you are just, it's like, I'm not going to let the devil have victory in my life. I'm going to root out, turn over to Jeremiah. I'm going to root out. I'm going to tear down. I'm going to be an enemy to the devil. I'm not going to be a friend to the devil. It's too many people I've seen pass away. It's too many people that I've seen devastated. It's too many people that have been destroyed. It's too many people that I've seen that look to be good people that have been taken out. The devil is the one responsible for earthquakes and damage and devastation. And you talk about catastrophes. The devil is the one doing that stuff. It's not God. It's the devil. So when are you going to determine that you love what? That you love God and hate the devil? When are you going to be determined that, you know what? I cannot peacefully coexist with somebody who really is plotting and planning and looking for me to go completely to nothing. And have me slobbering on myself, talking crazy and out, unable to even ascertain how to put on my own clothes. What I'm telling you is this, the devil means you no good. Everybody say it, the devil means me no good. Say, he's not my friend. And I refuse to be his friend. Jeremiah chapter 1. And we'll look at verse 6. Then said I, this is Jeremiah, who is a young man, being called of God to do the will of God. Then said I, Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. But the Lord said unto me, Say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, Behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. Everybody put a hand over your mouth. And let's read verse 9. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, Behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. Now touch your tongue and your lips. Because he says, I put my words in your mouth. And your lips and your tongue is anointed. Verse 10. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. What do you mean? God says, I'm doing a new thing. I have had enough of the devil's destruction. I am going to shut it down, and I'm going to use you to shut it down. And all the people of God said, Amen. Amen. We're born of God to raise up heaven and to raise down, mow down hell. Stand to your feet. Raising heaven means we're going to build, we're going to plant, we're going to change the societies in which we live in, the communities, the neighborhoods, the places where we work. We're going to make a difference. We are God's people, and God's people have God's assignment. We're not going to help the devil. We're not working for the devil. We're not punching in on his time clock. We're punching him out. And we're going to walk in victory. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Dear Father God, I thank you for
each and every. I want to thank you for tuning in today's lesson. If you would like to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, then I'm going to lead you into a confession of faith. If you say these words after me, you can become a child of the living God. In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, the Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Let us pray these words now, believing these words in our heart and saying them with our mouth. Dear God, I believe in my heart you sent your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to die for my sins. He was crucified. His blood was shed to wash me clean. And dear God, you raised him from the dead. So I confess with my mouth now, Jesus, you are my Lord and Savior. You are alive. I believe this in my heart. And because I confess you as my Lord, I am now a child of the living God. Father, thank you for making me your very own. I will live for you. You are in Jesus' name. Amen. That never
goes. I'd like to thank you for your continual support of this broadcast of Spirit Food Christian Center. We're so grateful for your participation. I'd like to give you an opportunity to participate by our Push Pay app. Text My SFCC to the number 77977. You'll receive further instruction on how to give. We're so grateful and thankful for your continual support and love. Remember, you're helping to make it happen. In Jesus' name,
you
amen.
Are the Son.